Thank you for watching Urban TV. On our show tonight, we shall be hosting one of the most prominent and renowned churchmen in Uganda and East Africa at large, that is Pastor Nicholas Wafula. He is known as the gentleman who started the Deliverance Churches in Uganda, and today he still continues to do his pastoral work. He is a man sought by so many people, leaders and in videos in different capacities, to seek his guidance on different aspects of life, be it leadership or even, you know, matters of religion. And today he still continues to do his pastoral work. So we are going to talk about his life in general, get to know him as a person, what journey he took since his, you know, childhood up to date to become the big man that he is today, and, you know, get some insights on what life ought to be, maybe as a Christian or just a normal Ugandan, let's say. So welcome to the show, Pastor Nicholas Wafula.
Thank you.
So if we could start, who is Pastor Nicholas Wafula?
Pastor Nicholas Wafula is a son of Zephania Fuho and Lydia Fuho, born in Mukango in the Busia district. Yeah, that's where he comes from.
Oh, interesting. So you come from the east side of the
yes.
country. All right. So what was life like growing up in, you say, Mukango village?
It was a typical village life. And sometimes I tell the people my story and they begin to wonder whether it's true. And one of the stories I have told several times is that I was born in a self-contained house. It was a grass-thatched house with a behind the door was the kitchen, and the firewood store was on the top, and then next was a pot of water, next was a pot of millet flour, because we are millet eaters. Next you would find some chickens laying eggs, some sitting on eggs. You find a goat, a sheep, a cow. And at night you will hear it doing churr, and then the next group would be us, the young ones. As a police in our tribe, before you are 12 years, you stay with your parents. After 12, you have to build your own hut in the compound somewhere. And then you come to an area where the adults were staying, and then at the door, normally you used to find a broken pot. And you know what that broken pot is all about. And the first person to go out in the morning will carry that broken pot with something which had been put in at night and empty it somewhere. Now, that's the house I was born at. I was not born in the hospital. My mother says I was born behind our house. It was drizzling, and that's why I'm called the Wafula, because I was born when it was raining. And she tells me after she had pushed me out, and then she called my dad to come and get me in to her house, as she took care of the other treatments on herself.
Hmm. Interesting story. So you were describing this house in Mukango,
yes.
And I'm wondering, are most homes like that? Is this a Samia thing? If I went to Busia, are those the kind of homes I would have found back then?
But you remember, I'm talking about some over 50 years ago.
Right.
So the changes have taken place.
Mm.
Yeah.
But was that the kind of homes we had back then?
Those who are not as privileged. My home was not as privileged as other homes. There were those who had more sophisticated homes other than just one grass-thatched house like ours.
So yours was not a privileged
no.
growth. Why do you say that? Because of
the surroundings, the conditions of my mother and my father, they were not one of these rich people.
But you turned out great. Today we are here talking to you. So what happened along the way?
It is God. It is God who did it.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So.
But one thing, even in there not being able to have much, they made sure that they educate us, and they took basically all of us to school. We were seven of us, four boys and three girls. At least each one of us went to school and got the work, just how I also went to school, and that's why I'm here, I'm sure.
All right, interesting. So you talk about growing up in a home that was not so privileged, but education was quite key for your parents. It's something they gave you. I wonder how that, where they got that heart for education from, and how education was quite important for you. How did you treasure this education they were giving, and why?
The background to it is that my father was a worker with the National Anglican Church, which these days is called Church of Uganda. So there was that religious component behind it, which I personally value and I treasure it. And I think that is what has made me to be what I am today, is the way they brought me up. At that time, I knew that is how Christians are brought up. You couldn't think of anything like alcohol coming home. You wouldn't find anybody smoking cigarettes at home. And that's what I knew as the Christianity. Until I went to secondary school, when I discovered that Christianity only comes when you receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and the Lord. So I value two things. One, the religious background I got from them, which I'm sure is the one which motivated them to take all of us to school to acquire some kind of education.
Wow. So I'm just wondering, I know you were a young person back then. I mean, when you're young, it comes with a lot of challenges. Were you never tempted to indulge in bad behavior, drinking perhaps, because you say alcohol is not allowed? No temptations at all for you as a young boy growing up at home?
I think all I can say, we were well protected. Uh-huh. We were very well protected. If you went somewhere, you had to tell the parents where you are going and what you are going to do. And I don't think during my early life, I don't remember being tempted with alcohol or smoking until secondary school. That's when the temptation came in.
What happened?
Yeah. I think I had a wrong friend in the senior two. We started I think he used to smoke, and he would give me to puff a little bit. And thank God, in the senior three, that's when I committed my life to Christ, and that was the end of the game. So I didn't test any of these alcohols or smokings, and I can say my family was very, very protective. And I didn't want to let my parents down when I left home to go to school.
Interesting. Oh, so at least we know in secondary school there was some sort of temptation, like any other normal child.
Yeah.
It happened and you outgrew the...
But it didn't last long.
How long was it anyway?
No, less than a year.
Less than a year.
Yeah.
Okay, that was short.
Totally wrong person, wrong friend.
Okay. Okay, so we know... they imparted you in this Christian values, which you took with you. Maybe it has made you what you are today. But I want to know, how did your journey into being born again start? I know you said you were brought up in this Anglican setting. I just want to know, from what point did it start to dawn on you that maybe I need to take this path? And what was that path like for you?
Yeah, when I went to secondary school, I went to Navumali High School, senior one, 1973. 63, and my house master happened to be also the chaplain of the school. And all I can say, the Lord led him to get some of us to be working in the chapel. And later on, when I was in senior three, he got three of us, paid our transport and all the conference fees at a conference in Kericho, Kenya. This was, I think, it was a Scripture Union conference. And in one of the evening meetings, I remember the preachers that he was a second year university in Nairobi University, but I don't remember his name. He preached on the young man who came to Jesus and asked, what can I do to inherit eternal life? Now, the way this preacher, the student, second year in Nairobi University put it, he said, the young man came with the right question. And he asked the question to the right person. And he got the right answer. But the young man did the wrong thing. Right question, asked the right person, got the right answer, but did the wrong thing. So the question that evening was, are you also going to do the wrong thing? And the majority of people put up their hands, responded to Jesus. And because of my religious background, I thought I was okay. Until they said, okay, if the others have gone, who wanted to be saved? Is there anybody here left with the, who has a question? Mm-hmm. And I stood up in that group. So we are ushered in the next room. Mm-hmm. When we reached there, they said, how many of you have decided to get saved now that you have moved from the other room to this room? Mm-hmm. And everybody moved on except three of us. Mm-hmm. And I do remember a reverend sat in the classroom corner. He was from Maseno, and I don't remember his name. He started calling us one by one. My turn came, and he asked me questions, because with my religious background, I had been baptized when I was young, I had been confirmed, I was in the church choir, and all that. And then after he had witnessed me, he said, now, would you, answered all my questions. He said, would you like to be saved? I said, yes. Now, he did something which most people, I think, don't do. Instead of leading me in a sinner's prayer, he just told me, let's open the Bible. They opened the Bible, Psalm 139, the last two verses. He said, if you mean what you say, now read that as your prayer. And to paraphrase it, it says, search me, O God, and see if there be any wickedness in me, and lead me to the life everlasting. And I said, amen. Now, believe me or not, even as I talk to you, I'm visualizing that classroom moment like it is today. That is what transformed me. I came back to Uganda, a changed person, and I transformed.
Wow. So after that experience, now you come back to Uganda. How do you continue that journey on your own, perhaps?
When I came back, of course, other people also had been saved. We formed a group of young people from 1 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 20, which says you are ambassadors for Christ. So we formed what we called Young Christian Ambassadors Fellowship. And that was in 1967. I was in senior five at that time. I got saved senior three, and we started this group in when I was in senior five. And we went out to preach. When others moved, most of us moved to Kampala, coming to universities and tertiary institutions, we still continued preaching in the marketplace, in the schools, and so on and so forth. What happened was that in about 1970, our mainline churches thought we were rebellious, because some of us were from Anglican Church, as I already mentioned, others were from Roman Catholic Church, and they decided to throw us out. Those are my only words. I don't know what they would say, but they actually thought we were rebellious, young people, and they threw us out. And what happened was that we used to have Saturday evening meetings every weekend. And what happened that when they threw us out, we now told the people who would come to the Saturday evening meeting to be able to come back on Sunday morning as our church service. And that was all started here at Wandegea, YMCA. That was where our meetings were. We used to call them Saturday revival meetings, and then we would have the Sunday services. Now, when that happened, other people came in, and we wouldn't continue to call ourselves young when there were older people in the church. Actually, I remember the first time somebody came in with a child and the child cried, everybody turned to see what was happening in the church. Okay, so eventually we felt the Lord was leading us to change the name. And we did pray over it. And because we were doing the work of Jesus, we went to Luke chapter 4, verse 18, which is a quotation from Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. That's what Jesus said. He has anointed me to preach good news to the poor and deliverance. At that time, we had only King James Version. So deliverance from the captivity. So that's where Deliverance Church came from.
We shall hold it there,
and
Pastor.
It has been there now, grown in Uganda, grown in Kenya, we are in Zambia, and so on. So that's a part of what continued or what happened when I came back.
Interesting. We shall take a break and then we shall come back.